Shalom. So we're live.
Shalom, shalom, shalom.
It's class day. So first and foremost, we want to give all praises to the Most High.
Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, Bahashem, Makakadash.
We want to give double honors to the apostles and the elders of Great Millstone. And shalom to all the brothers and, of course, the few sisters who are pursuing this truth in sincerity. All right, may the blessing of election be upon your house. All right, you guys.
Yep. So, yeah, man, today we're going to, you know, start off and get the example of Acts, the 15th chapter, you know, where there was a dispute between the circumcision, right, the Israelites that knew that they were Israelites, that believed in Yahweh Shai, and then made the argument of you having to be circumcised in the flesh in order to be saved. And then you had the apostles, you know, of Yahweh Shai pretty much lay down the foundation of, no, it's about circumcision of your mind, man. Circumcision of that flesh, you know, cutting off that old man, you right. know. Sure. And that's the whole point, you know, of Acts the 15th chapter, was the example of during that time, during the Roman Empire, you know, you had Israel that had fought tooth and nail in order to be able to preserve the laws, statutes and commandments. And pretty much they didn't want to fall away from that. But the understanding that came out of it is that Yahweh Shai supersedes the law, you know, through the Spirit. So we can start off in the first verse.
All right, so this is Acts 15 and 1. It reads, "And certain men which came down from Judea taught brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved." So, you know, like it says in Leviticus 12 and 3, that's the law.
Right.
On the eighth day. And continue on, verse 2, it reads, "When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. Mm-hmm. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles," the Israelite foreigners.
Yep, and by the way, Samaria, from a geological standpoint, I'll just get the illustration real quick. Samaria, I'm trying to find a good one. Yeah, okay, so here's a good picture of Samaria, right? So Samaria is in the red right here. You can see, I don't know if you can see that where it says Samaria. Samaria is known as pretty much the land mass above Judea. You can see Judea is right here,
right,
and then Samaria is above. So, you know, Paul and Barnabas, they had, you know, went up through Galilee and, you know, they came down to Judea to have this discussion, you know, but you have to pass through Samaria because Samaria is to the north of Judea.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Continuing on, verse 4 once more, it says, "And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that Yahweh had done with them."
Yeah, because reading up to this point, you know, there was already tour, if you will, that Paul and Barnabas had already done, proclaiming the gospel to the Israelite foreigners that were scattered throughout the various parts of the Middle East. And pretty much, you know, they were received like how when a brother comes in from out of town, we salute them. You know, we ask the brother how everything's going. Back then, there was no cell phones, there was no internet. So the only way to hear from somebody, if you didn't write a letter to them, was to see him in person, you know. Right. So you know, you can put yourself in that situation. All right, go ahead.
Verse 5, it says, "But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them and to keep the law of Moses." Yeah.
Yep, because you had Israelites that believed in Yahweh Shai, okay, that were raised under the customs of
Mosaic law.
The Mosaic law, man.
Can I get a precept? St.
John 1:17, it says, "For the law was given by Moses,"
right,
"who was given to by through Moses, but grace and truth came by Yahweh Shai HaMashiach," you know, and that's what was being pushed by the apostles and disciples at that time, you know?
Yeah.
Waking up the Gentiles, you know, who have been scattered according to prophecy, you know, amongst the different lands among the heathens, like the Sumerians, like we just went into.
That's right.
You know, go ahead.
Okay, you got one. Go ahead.
Yeah. This is Galatians chapter 5 and verse 1. It says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Mashiach hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. The yoke of bondage meaning the works of the law that are pretty much added unto, but Yahusha really he supersedes that. Again, he made certain things obsolete. For example, the sacrificial law.
That's the main thing.
You know, that's the main thing, you know. I mean, also, but circumcision in itself, it was required for a man to be circumcised according to the law.
Correct.
But again, we're gonna get the Romans 4, you know what I'm saying? But it's a token of the faith that you have, man.
Yeah.
Right.
So I mean, you don't
really. Yeah. You have to be circumcised in your mind. Heart, in your mind, really, right. Your spirit,
yep.
Not just on the outward appearance. That's what was being pushed as well.
That's right.
Because those Pharisees, they was going off. You know,
if somebody could get 1 Corinthians 7 and 17, so you start at 17. The point is in 18, 19.
Yeah.
Yes. You got it. Yep.
I got it. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 17. It says, "But as God had distributed to every man, that the Lord hath called everyone." So let him walk, and so ordain I and all the churches.
Mm-hmm.
18. Is any man called being circumcised?
Yep.
Let him not be uncircumcised. Is any called in uncircumcision? Let him not be circumcised.
So that same topic is being brought up here. But go on. It gives you the same perspective that the Elder Yadikar just brought up. It's going to tell you the same thing. Go ahead.
19. Circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing. But the keeping of the commandments of God.
But the being circumcised in the mind. Exactly. Being a doer of the word and not a hearer only.
Exactly.
That's what the conclusion of the whole matter was. So that's what we're going into here. So I guess I can go back to Acts.
You mind if I
you have another precept?
No, well, it's just the finishing off on that Galatians 5.
Oh, my bad. I catch you up.
That's all good. So Galatians 5 and 2, it says, "Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, that if ye be circumcised, Mashiach shall profit you nothing." So that's the same sentiment that he had when he was, you know, disputing with the Israelites that were saying and teaching that you got to be physically circumcised in order to be saved. That's a big thing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, in order to attain salvation, you got to be circumcised. Let's get the understanding of during that time, most Israelites that grew up outside of, you know, Judea, they weren't circumcised, man.
Right.
You know? And so this is after Peter, you know, he went to Cornelius, you know, and the Lord revealed, you know, to Peter that, you know, yeah, the Israelite foreigners, they count too, you know what I mean, to be able to be covered by the blood of Yahushua as long as they believe.
Right.
You know, so but a lot of those Israelites were, again, Hellenized, so they didn't come up under the customs of how they're supposed to.
And Father, if I could say Abraham. Mm-hmm. You know, his third coming out of Ur of Chaldees. Mm-hmm. He wasn't circumcised, but he still received the promise, mm-hmm. not being circumcised, like we're going to go into when we get Romans the 4th chapter.
Okay.
Because they always want to proclaim the father Abraham. He wasn't circumcised,
yeah.
You know, but he still got the promise just through his belief.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. the fact that he believed it was accounted for righteousness. That's what the scripture says about Abraham.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
This is Colossians 2, verse 13. It says, "And you being dead in your sins, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has quickened together with him, having forgiven all the trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances, and was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross." Mm-hmm. So that, like I said, that uncircumcision has been, you know, you circumcised, you know, that's something that like a lot of scribes, they were actually pushing it, you know. But now we see that with the house shot, he put laid upon the cross.
Right.
So that goes forth with us having
Shalom.
That basically going with that mercy and basically getting that the handwritten law, not so far just done away with,
but yeah.
Basically he succeeded it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Which the circumcision is good, it's clean, yeah. But
right.
It's through faith first though.
Right.
And then through that process of your experience of faith, you're going to want to be obedient. You're going to go get circumcised. You
that's
know?
Right.
That's the whole thing. It's not, salvation isn't able to be obtained by the workings of the law.
Right.
It's by faith in Yahweh Shinyon Shai. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much the doctrine that they were trying to come with. Like, no, you have to be circumcised to be able to be
right.
saved.
Right.
Right.
Which is far from the truth. You know?
There's a precept on the comment board. from GMS Truth Be Told 144, and then I guess we can get yours. But he put up Jeremiah 4:4 and said, okay, that's the spirit. Well, you go ahead and read it, brother, and then we'll just have it.
I'll start at verse 1.
Okay.
It's Jeremiah 4:1. If thou would return, right, that word return in the Hebrew is shawah, which means to repent, turn back to. Mm-hmm. Right? So he says, if thou shalt return, O Israel, says the Lord, Yahweh shall return unto me, and if you will put away thine abominations out of my sight, then shalt thou not remove. So it started with, you know, us, first and foremost, repentance, you know, calling back, you know, the mind to life, and calling back to mind our transgressions. You know, that was the first, that's what the Lord was looking for, not the outward workings of the flesh. Right? I'm skipping out of verse 3. It says, for thus saith the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, so northern kingdom and southern kingdom, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns, pretty much meaning cultivate your mind. Right? And don't, you know, and sow the seed of the word, you know, upon a good mindset on that, those, going back to Mark 4th chapter, you know, how you had, that seed to fall upon a different.
Yeah, seed parable.
Fall upon different, you know, grounds. Right, verse 4 says, circumcise yourselves to the Lord and take away the foreskin of your heart. That word heart in Hebrew is la'av, which means your mind. So that's as the brothers would bring it out, that's what you circumcise is your mind, first and foremost. Mm-hmm. It says, ye men of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my fury come forth like fire and burn that none can quench it because of the evil of your doings. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, like when Christians read, you know, the so-called New Testament, whatnot, they start bugging out. See, you ain't got to keep the law no more because, you know, Paul said, don't matter if you're circumcised. Well, that's really, the Lord was always emphasizing that, even back then, man, because when you read Jeremiah the 9th chapter, he says that the circumcised are going to die along with the uncircumcised, meaning the nation of Israel, if they ain't not right, they're going to die wrong along with Edom, Moab, right, and Egypt, you know, So it's first and foremost continuing to learn, you know, that mindset, you cultivating that mindset and having a soft mind towards your how much my shaman repentance.
Renewing of the mind. Yeah. Yep. That's what happened in 70 AD, man.
The circumcision got they asses handed to them, man. You know, showing you that it's not by the works. Well, I mean, they wasn't keeping the law anyway in large, but you know, it's about the faith in Yahweh Shah, especially in these times, because we don't have no temple physically to offer up sacrifices as an atonement for our sins, you know? And I have something for y'all.
Of course.
Okay. This is Romans chapter 3 and verse 28. Matter of fact, yeah, I'll start in verse 28. It says, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. So, you know, you can read up, but pretty much, again, man, you're going to show forth your faith through the works of Yahweh Hashem Yahshai, but the thing is, like, keeping the law, the you know, the actual 613 commandments, that's an outline of it. You know, it's about the spirit of the law that's really, you know, going to make a man to be walking in the way that he's supposed to. Okay, it says in verse 29, it says, is he the power of the Jews only? Is he not also the power of the Gentiles? Yes, the Gentiles also, meaning the Israelite foreigners. Again, because the whole deal with Acts the 15th chapter was, if you're not circumcised, if you're not a Jew, right? If you're not circumcised, because that was the whole thing, the uncircumcision and the circumcision. The Israelites that were raised up in the laws, it was keeping the Passover and the Day of Atonement and the Sabbath, and the Israelites that weren't, you know, that were growing up Hellenized. Right. Well, no. The Most High is the power of the Gentiles, the Israelite foreigners, also.
Right.
Because we were all in these times now in 2022.
Yeah.
We were all raised up as Gentiles, man, worshiping right. Christmas and Halloween and all that stuff.
And we all had to circumcise ourselves in the mind.
Right.
Well, it's not ourselves, the Lord circumcised.
But except for a war.
Hey, yo.
He was raised as an Israelite.
He was raised as
an Israelite. It's two more verses. If y'all mind. It says, verse 30, Acts 3 and 30, seeing it is one power which shall justify the circumcision by faith and uncircumcision through faith, do we then make void the law through faith? Most High forbid. Yea, we establish the law.
Right.
You know, so we walk according to the law, statutes, the commandments to the best of our ability. The scriptures say we're going to rehearse the righteous acts.
Right.
You know, But ultimately, you know, Galatians 3:11 says that no man's going to be justified and saved by the works of the law, man. So, but anyway,
Somebody on the comment board backs you up. And somebody wants to get Romans 2:29.
Start at 28, actually.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, shout out, big up to the brother GMS, Truth Behold, 144. Or Truth Behold.
Truth Be Told.
144.
Yeah.
That's a banger right there.
Yeah.
It's the book of Romans, chapter 2, verse 28. It says, for he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is the outward in the flesh.
Right, it has to be you have to be circumcised of your heart.
Right.
But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly.
Right, he is a Jew, which is one inwardly.
Yeah.
You know? The Lord knows the intents of the heart, you know? Go ahead.
And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of the Most High.
Right, because with the different things, like the tokens and the phylacteries and all of those different things, that's just really for to please men. But the Lord, he knows the intent of men, your heart.
That's right.
So that's where you have to be circumcised. That's where you have to be a Jew inwardly, you know? That's why Yahweh Shah was cursing out those Pharisees in Matthew the 23rd chapter. You know, he said, clean the inside. You know, that's pretty much the point I want to get on that.
Okay.
You got precepts?
Okay. So Philippians 3 and verse 3 in the NLT. I'm starting verse 2 because, you know, Paul's pretty much saying the same thing in all his epistles, just in different ways to different churches. Verse 2 is said, and this is the NLT, says, watch out for those dogs, those people who do evil. Those mutilators who say you must be circumcised to be saved.
And that word mutilator, if you read it in the King James Version, it goes into concision. And that was really a negative connotation because it was a play on words. Those are the circumcision or the concision, right? When you mutilate somebody's circumcision, it's a concision, you know? It's a mutilation.
Yeah.
That's what they were doing to the law.
Yeah.
Because they were putting all these constraints and things of that nature on the people, which they themselves wanted to keep them law.
Yeah.
In its entirety. Now, they were adamant about certain laws being published, but certain laws that was, you know, were seen as spiritual, they weren't keeping them. Case in point, when you read in Matthew, and Yahweh Shah cut them and said, well, you don't take care of your mother and your father. You say it is a kabban, meaning it's a gift. So the money that you're supposed to be taking to take care of your family, your mother and your father, you say, oh, well, this is a gift for the temple, so I'm not going to give it to my parents. So when it came to being spiritual, they weren't keeping the law. They weren't being in the spirit about the law.
Exactly. That's the fact. They weren't in the spirit of the law.
Spirit of right. law.
Meaning having a spirit of judgment and discernment.
Right.
You know? When you get your cow out of the ditch, your goat out of the ditch on the Sabbath. You know? It's just practical things. You have to, you know, be in the spirit of the law. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just had a quick point to land back on what you said. This is Matthew 23:23. She says, this is Yahweh Shah speaking. It says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. For you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and has omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith.
Mm.
Right. So judgment, mercy, faith, being, you know, we have, you know, there's certain scenarios in which, okay, judgment can rain down, but there's scenarios when you're supposed to have mercy too. The one case in point, the woman which was, you know, an adulteress. Saying it would jump from man to man. They were trying to bring her up. They knew who this woman was. They knew about her, right? But they brought her up to accuse Yahweh Shah. They weren't being in the spirit. Yeah, she had fault, and they could have used that situation as to implement the law, but they weren't in the spirit of the law, if you will, or the implementation of the law.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Meaning, okay, yeah, I could point this person's faults out, but y'all been knowing that this was going on. Some of y'all probably, you know, was a trick daddy more than likely. But you want to use this situation as a way to one up Yahweh Shah. You're not being in the spirit.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Mercy rejoice over judgment. you know, in certain situations, you know, where it could apply if you're in the spirit, you know. That's why Yahweh Shah said those are the weightier matters. What, justice or judgment, mercy, knowing when it, to show mercy and when to apply judgment, and faith at the end of the day, you know, which this thing is about faith, you know. Go ahead.
It says these are ye have to have done and not to leave the other undone. And that was pretty much the point on that one.
Yeah, that whole Matthew 23 is good. Yeah. Yes, that's solid right there for brothers, just in your spare leisure reading time.
Right.
It was one more verse on here.
Go ahead.
Verse 3, Philippians 3 and 3 in the NLT says, for we who worship by the Spirit of the Most High, is like the brothers going into, you know, at John 4 and 22. You know, for those who worship the Most High, must worship Him in spirit and in truth, right? In the inward man, because at the end of the day, the Lord didn't create your spirit with fringes on it. He created your spirit, you know, right. That's it. Like, that's all we taking out of this place with us to be changed, man, to the glorious bodies. We're not, all this external things, garments, these robes, he's about to be burnt up, you know? So the Lord is refining the inward man.
That's right.
It says, for we who worship by the Spirit of the Most High are the ones who are truly circumcised. We rely on what Hamashiach Yahawashah has done for us, and that's the case. We rely on His sacrifice. Case in point, all right, tomorrow night, we got the Day of Atonement coming in.
Correct.
We're relying upon Him, you know, Lord willing, our slate is clean. Not because of what we've done, because we come to the realization that we're Israelites, which that wasn't even in and of ourselves.
Yeah.
That was stripped from the Spirit. So He says, we put no confidence in human effort, because at the end of the day, nobody can boast. We're all subject unto vanity.
Yeah.
So what do we have to boast about our efforts? Because even us holding camp, bro, we can't hold camp long enough to please the Lord.
Right.
Like, you know, all this has to be done in faith. The sacrifice has to be done in faith, you know? You can hold camp 7 days a week, you know, 365, but your human effort ain't going to make you right. At the end of the day, that's why the brother had I know before he left, was going to Romans 4 chapter. It's all going to the sure mercy of David at the end of the day.
Because our righteousness is as filthy rags, as the scriptures say. It's beautiful. Anybody else have any more precepts before we go back to Acts 15?
I don't.
No? If you have something, go ahead.
Yeah. Well, it's the parable of the Pharisee and I believe and the publican, pretty much how the publican, you know, we don't have to grab the whole thing. But
just trying to get through it quickly. Yeah. If you want to read it, just, you know.
Yeah.
This is Luke 18, and you start at verse 9, and it's, you know, Yahweh Shai says, and He spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray, and one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, the Most High, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. So he esteemed himself better because of the works that he was doing.
Yeah.
Right? I keep the law, like he's going to say, I fast twice in a week, I give tithes of all that I possess. Like, I'm doing all that I need to do. Like,
yeah.
So he looked at himself as justified because of that.
Which those things are like a pleasing opinion too. Like, look at me, look at what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Right.
Not knowing that the Lord looks at what you're doing when nobody's around.
Right.
But the publican came with the right mindset.
Right.
It says, verse 13, and the publican standing afar off would not lift up so much as his eyes into heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God be merciful to me, I am a sinner.
Right.
See, and that's the right mindset to have. We're sinners, man. We're not perfect.
Yeah, exactly.
We don't seek to be justified by the law, bro.
You don't want to be under that weight.
You know, bro.
That's a curse.
That's a curse. That's right, bro.
You'll be condemned because, like you just said, we can't keep it perfectly. You know?
Finishing off, verse 14, it says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalted himself shall be abased, and he that humbled himself shall be exalted.
Yeah, he was in that broken and contrite spirit, as we ought to be. Now, that guy who was making it about himself, you'll notice a lot of the guys that fall out of the truth, they in that spirit. Oh, look what I'm doing. Look at me. If you in the look at me spirit, man, the Lord's going to remove you.
Yep.
Odi Arala made that beautiful point. Guys don't know what they're a part of when they step into this thing.
Right.
Okay, what can you add to the group? It's not about you. You're not going to be the one getting the shine all the time.
Right.
Sometimes you're not going to feel good.
Right.
You know, sometimes you'll be low in the spirit. That's a part of the conditions of our battle, man.
Right. And it's the Lord's business at the end of the
day.
That's why it says in Luke, the 14th chapter, you have to count the cost.
Yeah.
Whether you have sufficient to finish the building.
Right.
You can't put your hands to the plow and look back, or you're not fit for the kingdom.
Yes.
So a lot of people, they don't really understand the nature of what they're a part of. They think this is just some clicked up, you know, but they're not understanding you come in to serve.
Yeah.
And in the servitude role, a lot of times you're going to have to prefer someone else over your own needs.
Yeah.
And in this flesh, that's something that we haven't been classically trained up to do.
Right.
You know?
Especially being here in our captivity.
Exactly.
Jake is looking for
that's
notoriety.
What we need mercy. That's like the brother just read. That's the point I was trying to come to.
Yeah, yeah. You know? So, yeah, man, that was a beautiful, you know, point to bring out, man.
Absolutely.
Because there's a particular spirit that we have to be in this thing for the long haul. And in sports, they say, what? Most guys are going to be role players. So you got to come to terms with this. What can I nurture and bring to the table to help the team get to that common goal? We're trying to help usher in the kingdom, man.
Yeah. Let me put my needs away just for the greater collective to win at the end of the day.
Understand.
To get the ring, basically. Because it's a team effort, but everybody gets a ring, right?
Yeah.
Whether you were on the sixth man on the bench, the 10th, you know, whatever.
Or whether you were the practice squad guy that pushed the starters to perform better.
Right, right.
You understand? You got to be about something bigger than yourself.
Right.
And if you can't get over that, if you can't grow up and get over that, bro, you're not going to last.
Yeah, knowing your role. It's a body, and everybody has different, functions within the body. So you got to master what the Lord giving you, and don't be really looking to what the next man been set up to do.
Right.
Just master what the Most High gave you, your gift. Flip the talent that you've been given.
Stay in your lane.
That's a part of, you know, considering what you're a part of, you know.
All right. So is that it on that?
Yeah.
We're going to go back to Acts 15.
I didn't want to get off too far, of course, but, you know, I don't want to make that point along with your point, you know.
Yeah, that's good. Anybody else? All right.
We can go back.
We're back to Acts 15.
I think we want to get some of, like, Romans, the fourth chapter, too.
Okay. Want me to go there first?
Well, no. We can continue, and then at some point just kind of segue
back into Romans. You got Romans?
I already did.
What was that in Acts 15? Like, was it more that you wanted to get?
It was mainly down to like verses 13 to 17.
Yeah, just continue.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
And we'll just continue to rock and roll.
Okay, shalom, baby.
You want me to read?
Oh, okay. Okay.
It's Acts 15 and verse 5 again. It says, but there rose up certain the sect of the Pharisees which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. And we just broke that down. It says, and the apostles and elders came together for it to consider this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago the Most High made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe.
Mm-hmm.
And we know those Gentiles were, you know, those Israelite foreigners, right? Pursuant to Hosea, the first chapter, like Romans 9:26.
Yep.
You know,
John 7:35. You know, if somebody want to get that for people that's new, so that you understand, we're reading these Gentiles. It's not what they teach in the church. It's not. We're not talking about anybody from any other nation. No, there were Israelites scattered into all these different nations, the diaspora. Right.
I got one too. Whenever.
Okay.
Somebody post something.
Yeah, the John 7:35. You got something?
Yeah.
Let me get the 7:35 because there you go.
Nah, go ahead. Y'all go ahead. Sean, okay. I'll get this later.
John 7:35. You got it.
Yeah. Just the book of John, chapter 7:35. It says, then said the Jews among themselves, whither will he go, that we shall not find him? Will he go unto the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles?
Will he go to the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles? Now, somebody get that in the NLT because it makes it so plain. When you read an NLT, it's very, you know, clear on what it's talking about. All right? Hey, Shalom, brother.
I got it. John 7:35 in the NLT, it says, the Jewish leaders were puzzled by his statement. Where is he planning to go, they asked. Is he thinking of leaving the country and going to the Jews and other lands?
The Jews and other lands. All right? So it's very plain, you know, adding on to the brother's point. So when you hear us talk about the Gentiles, and the uncircumcised, these were Israelites scattered into different countries who grew up just like us in Babylon, just like Abraham, right? Not understanding the ways they were supposed to keep. But they came into the fold. Now they were in that willing spirit, that broken and contrite spirit to change, to be quick about the word, right? All right.
I got a quick one. Just
okay, okay. And I know you had some.
Tobit 13:3. Confess him before the Gentiles, you children of Israel, for he had scattered us among them.
Yeah. Claim.
Been scattered through the prophecy, man.
Right.
Falling away, going after other idols, the Lord has scattered, man. Our own sin came upon us to our detriment.
That's good.
Okay. So Yahweh Shai came back to the store, you know, what was lost. He just said that. I came not before the lost sheep, but I was
Yeah.
I got one.
I think. Okay. So y'all got something. Okay.
I don't want to stop the flow of the spirit, man. Hosea 8:8 it says, "Israel swallowed up. Now shall they be among the Gentiles in the vessel wherein is no pleasure."
So, hey, it's from the point.
And that's ultimately why we need grace, too, if I can just say. And I'll go ahead and get the precept now.
Okay.
Galatians 5:2 It says, "Behold, I, Paul, saying to you that if you be circumcised, a Mashiach shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Which if you offend in one, you offend in all." James, it tells you that too, right? It says, "Hamashiach is become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, you are fallen from grace." So those that think that they're good according to the law, you're not bound by the grace. It says you're fallen from grace.
I'm sorry, but that was Galatians 5?
Mm-hmm. I mean, Galatians 5.
Okay.
I'll read verse 5. It says, "For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith, which our forefather Abraham received while he was in an uncircumcised state."
Right.
You know, we're hoping to get that grace at the end of the day. That's the point being made.
I got one more.
Let's do it.
Galatians 2:21 it says, "I do not frustrate the grace of the Most High, for if righteousness cometh by the law, then Hamashiach is dead in vain." And that's essentially what the scribes and Pharisees were trying to do, man. They were frustrating the grace of Yahweh, you know, Shai. They pretty much were saying, I'm sorry.
No, I was agreeing with you. I was going to say, the people who he was talking against in this particular letter was the Judaizers. And the Judaizers was much like what we read in Acts, the 15th chapter. They were Israelites who believed in Yahweh, but they were proponents for the law. They were zealous for the law, so they was just like in the Galatians. You could use this the book of Galatians as a precept to what was going on in Acts. They were pushing the law, and so this is really Paul expounding on the whole situation that was going on in Acts, the 15th chapter. You see what I'm saying? He's like, that's why he says, Why are you so bewitched? What's he paraphrasing? You know what I'm saying? So easily removed from what you were just taught. You know what I'm saying? Did you receive the grace of Yahushua by the works of law or by faith?
Exactly.
You see what I'm saying? It talks about that in Galatians. You dig? But it's really him expounding, or this book is expounding on the concept of the Judaizers, you see, and how they were causing division and confusion with him pushing the law. And a small part of that history, you got to think, these books are contemporary. They were written around the same time. You see, all these events were going on around the same time. You see, and a small example of that is Acts the 15th chapter. You see, of the book of Galatians. See,
I'm gonna read it in the NLT if that's
what you're doing. Right,
no way. Galatians 2:21 in the NLT it says, "I do not treat the grace of the Most High as meaningless. For if keeping the law can make us right with the Most High, then there was no need for the Mashiach to die." Blank period. You know what I'm saying?
Why would he have to go on the cross?
Yeah,
you know
what I'm saying? Exactly. So,
yep.
Yeah, that was the
So going back to Acts 15 chapter, and he says, let's see, verse 7 says, "And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago the Most High made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe." You know, and what gospel do you think that was that he was speaking about? The Isaiah 61 gospel, man, the same one that Yahweh Shah, you know, reiterated in Luke the 4th chapter. And it says, verse 8. "And the Most High, which knoweth the hearts, the minds," right? And it's a slacky. "And the Most High, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Spirit, even as he did unto us." And when you read, I want to say Galatians, the 4th or 5th chapter, you know, it speaks about how Abraham received the Holy Spirit before he was circumcised. You know, so the same thing for the seed of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in these times. In this Babylon, or wherever we may be scattered, you know, the Lord is dealing the same manner, you know, but he expects you, you know, once you once he calls you, for you to repent and have trust and faith in him that wherever he's going to lead you to, you know, that he, you know, that he's going to guide you there, man, just like he did Abraham.
Basically, part of the wilderness, if I may make a point, in the wilderness, that that new generation that was coming in to the promised land, one thing also, too, what was going on is that Jake wasn't circumcised on them. You know what I'm saying? Like they left off the customs, even that the older generation that came out of Egypt wasn't circumcising like that, the newer generation coming in. And they still, that the second generation coming in still was told to go into the promised land.
They entered into.
So it's, you know, it's the same, you know what I'm saying, a very similar aspect to it. You know, it's like,
you guys know? So going back to Acts 15, well, as a matter of fact, I found it in Galatians, the fifth chapter. This is one of them. I believe there may be one third. Okay, here we go. This is Galatians chapter 3 and verse 2. I'm getting an NLT. Says, let me ask you this one question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the laws of Moses?
That's the chapter I was
alluding to. Oh, that's what, okay.
It started 1.
Okay. It's Galatians 3 and 1 in the NLT. Says, O foolish Galatians, who has cast an evil spell on you? Yeah, okay. It says, for the meaning of Yahusha Mashiach's death was made as clear to you as if you had seen a picture of his death on the cross. Let me ask you this one question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the law of Moses? Of course not. You received the Spirit because you believed the message you heard about Mashiach. God. Yeah, and that's the same case for us today, man. You know, like us brothers, like we didn't, because I believe it was Preacher R, he was going into it today. You know, even when he heard this message for the first time, he was still, you know, as all of us, we were still doing particular things that the Lord wasn't pleased with, but he was still dealing with this.
Right.
Because we had an expecting mind, you know, and a willing heart, you know, to be made right.
The Lord winked at our ignorances.
That's right.
Understanding, we got that word. What did he do? He tells us to do the word. Faith without works is dead.
Yeah.
You know, so we didn't hear the word and just say, okay, I heard it, I'm gonna go sit down. And,
yeah.
Like, hey, the two thirds heard the word before, like you said, before the end comes. Yeah. The thing is that the telling of the, you know, the word tells us to actually move and basically become the new man.
Rehearse
like that.
Right.
So it says, verse 3, he says, how foolish can you be? After starting your new lives in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort?
Yes.
So, you know, he was getting frustrated with them, man, because you had those particular, you know, cats of the circumcision, you know, as you said in the first verse, you know, trying to bewitch them. You know, Colossians 2nd chapter speaks about don't let any of these men, you know, spoil you through vain philosophy and deceit, man. You know, he was saying the same thing in all his epistles to the different churches, man.
Yeah.
Because what he's saying in Acts 20th chapter, he says, I fear after I come unto you, there'll be some that's not going to be sparing the flock. They're going to try to take away the faith that the fundamental belief and believing in Yahusha away and try to have you put a stop in your own effort, which that's silly, man. You know, you read Job the 4th chapter, it says that the Lord charges his own angels with folly, man. And they don't sin. So how much those who live in houses of clay.
Because we actually angels too.
John.
Angels in chains of darkness. So we charge the folly. So like what you're going into, it's like at that point, in that case, how are you gonna put something back on the followers or the believers that believe in the party? How are you gonna put something on them that we couldn't even keep? You know, like Elder Mike Harlow was going into that whole like what Paul was breaking down in that Galatians, the first chapter, is what those Judaizers was doing. That's as they call them, quote unquote Judaizers. You know, it's the same thing. You know, we heard this word through faith, and that's what caused us to believe. That's what sparked the belief instantly. It wasn't the working of miracles. It was that spark of faith in our mind, which is a miracle, that the Lord put that spark or that energy into us to even believe upon his son.
That's right.
And that's I was just going to say, that's why, you know, scriptures made key to mention that he was teaching it to those Gentiles the word of the gospel, because that's the importance of the true gospel being broken down correctly here in these latter days. Because what else are you going to put your faith in, man?
Yeah.
You know, like you hearing about it, you're the chosen seed of Yahweh Shemasha. The kingdom is for you. Rulership, everlasting. But, well, first and foremost, you're going to be a right standing with the one who made everything. you know, the God of the universe, right? So that's gonna cause you to put your faith, you know, in Him, man. You know, and hearing this true gospel, because Christianity, there's different forms of gospels, man. Because everybody, that word gospel just simply means news,
yeah,
good tidings, right? Everybody has their own form of good news and good tidings,
right?
But this is the true gospel, man.
Yeah.
Who have believed that report?
Yeah.
Acts 15 and verse 8. It says, and the Most High, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Spirit. And those that was being born witness are those that was with him from the beginning. Pursuant to John 15, last verse. And you shall bear witness of me, those that was with me in the beginning, wrote the paraphrase. And it says, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Spirit, even as he did unto us. And put no difference between us and them, because that middle wall partition was torn down.
Yeah.
Pursuant to Ephesians 2nd chapter. And it says, purifying their hearts by faith.
Uh-huh. Oh, you can read.
Okay.
You can read 10.
Okay, verse 10 says, now therefore, why tempt ye the Most High to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear?
Is it Galatians 5? Did we read Galatians 5 and 1?
I read a little bit of it.
I didn't read the NLT.
God.
That's why it was hard to follow.
Okay.
Because
God.
I read like verses 2 and 3, I think.
Galatians 5 and 1, we read that?
I didn't read verse 1, though.
Yeah.
I can start. Hold on.
Yeah.
I'll go back to it. This is back in Galatians 5 and 1. It says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Hamashiach hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage.
Yeah, man. He made us free from, you know, having to depend on our own human effort to be delivered.
Right.
You understand? So you go into what we just read, verse 10, because it says that we weren't able to bear it or keep it.
That's a curse of the law, man.
You know what
I mean? You can't keep it.
You done.
The law is good if it can be kept, you know, but it's a curse if you can't keep it, you know?
Yeah, you're done. So we needed that sacrifice. Go ahead.
John, can I read this?
Yeah, absolutely.
Hey, this is according to my study Bible. Now, this is the occasion for which the book of Galatians was written. Since Paul had led the Galatians to Mashiach, they had made a good start in the Christian life and were doing well spiritually. Later, some Jewish teachers called Judaizers taught the Galatians that to be saved, one must not only believe in Mashiach, but must also obey the Mosaic law, the sign of which is circumcision. So circumcision that day embodies more than just the cutting of the flesh.
Right.
Embodies like basically what it really means, cut off from the world. Mm-hmm. You know, say you're falling after the Mosaic law.
Right.
You did.
It's good.
In teaching this heresy, they also attacked Paul's apostleship and gospel. The false gospel had a detrimental effect on the Galatians. It was beginning to hinder their obedience to the Most High. They were starting to observe some parts of the law, and they were considering a complete acceptance of the law. Purpose. Paul seeks to expose the errors of the Judaizers' gospel and their impure motives. Galatians 6, starting at verse 12.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Because they were doing it really for hidden agendas.
Yeah.
You know, that's why a lot of these guys, they push the whole concept of, we got to follow the law. Because they can make merchandise out of the...
out of the flock.
Out of the flock.
Yeah. And we dealing with those same, you know, spirits today.
Right.
Because you have certain sects of people who know that they're Israelites, but it's, well, you got to do this.
Right.
But here's our starter packets.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
They're not in the spirit of the law.
Right.
They're just completely out of the spirit, just ultimately, man.
Yep. Right.
Can I read this in Galatians?
Of course.
Broke back of what I'm saying. Galatians 6 and 12. And as many as desire to make a fair shoe in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Mashiach. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised that they may glory in your flesh.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Pretty much glorifying the fact that look at my converts, look what I got them to do.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? On the outward appearance, where the circumcision is really the circumcision of your mind.
Yeah.
That's what
y'all was
pushing.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yep. You had the Pharisees adding law on top of the law. You see, that's why when you read in Mark, the 7th chapter, the Pharisees came and said, wow, so why don't your congregation, wash their hands?
Right.
Well, that was implemented by the Pharisees to ensure that everything was clean.
Yeah.
Right. They had that law.
Yeah.
That wasn't a law.
It's like a tradition of men.
Custom.
Tradition of men. So you have, what do you have? You have people that say, hey, in order for you to get a part of my camp, you have to legally change your name to an Israelite name.
Crazy.
You have to go to the court. Wow. That's adding on to the law.
And in turn doing that, they're making themselves a target.
Yeah.
You know, especially in this time, man. We can't keep the whole law on this side if we wanted to. All right?
The glory in the flesh.
The glory in the flesh.
Yep.
So, you know, people that are in that spirit, they actually don't get what we're actually fighting for. They're fighting for something else.
They're not looking at the spirit of just being right just because it's the right thing to do, but just for the outward approval and appearance of men.
Yeah.
You know, not seeking the approval from the Most High, which sees the inward part that knows your thoughts.
Yeah. That was whited sepulchres.
Right. Yeah, that Matthew 23, your house shall go in there.
Yep. Okay. Anybody else?
I had a quick one. Okay. Just to kind of prove the point, like pretty much we broke one, we broke it all. So this is James 2 and 10. It says, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all.
Oh, yeah.
So again, the point already been made. Pretty much if righteousness came by the law, like bro, why did Yahweh Shai have to come?
We done.
You know what I'm saying? We'd be done if that's the case.
Because we got to work on the Sabbath. Ain't nobody got no lamb without blemish for Passover.
In separate quarters, like during her cycle.
Yeah,
we never got none of our women as virgins. Like,
right.
Yeah. You
know. All adulterers and adulteresses.
Come on,
man. You know what I mean?
You ain't separating yourself out from your sins.
Right.
Taking a whole bath.
your clothes is mixed fabrics.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, right there.
We really keeping the Passover, man.
Yeah.
We the big cutoff. You know what I'm saying? We can't keep the Passover.
Yeah, that's right. So it's really foolish when that vibration is being pushed. You know?
I'll make you always try to sacrifice the bad.
Yeah,
exactly.
At the end of the day.
It was all about the law, by keeping the law 100%. That's why when you read in Romans 4 chapter 2, Romans 3, it talks about the law of faith.
Matter of fact, can somebody grab Ephesians 2 and 8 about Kushar for them? Just to add to the priest Taz Amaz point.
Ephesians 2 and 8.
It's all about faith, man, the law of faith, being in the spirit just to be righteous and to judge righteously, you know?
I got it. Oh, you got it? Go ahead, brother.
It's in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8.
Mm-hmm.
For by grace are you saved through faith.
Because that's ultimately the justification. You're going to be saved by grace through faith in Yahweh Shai. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
And not of yourself.
And not of ourselves. Not of what we can do within the works of the law. Go ahead.
It is the gift of Yahweh Shai.
And it's a gift. The gift is something that you receive. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So it ain't nothing that came of our own merit. It's a gift. Go ahead, Dad. It's going to explain what I want to explain. Really, go ahead.
Not of works, lest any man should boast.
Not of works, lest any man should boast about what I'm doing. Look at me, what I'm doing in the law. You know, that's why the Most High has set it up like that. This is a thing of faith. You know, go ahead.
For we are his workmanship, created in Himashiach Yahweh Shai, unto good works.
Unto good works. We should have the intentional mindset as Yahweh Shai himself to do good works. Let this mind be in you that was in Yahweh Shai Mashiach.
That's right.
Not just to try to please men and boast about what we can do in the flesh. We all need to be saved. We all need mercy and grace at the end of the day. Because we're not perfect. The only one that did it perfectly is Yahweh Shai. That's why his sacrifice is a perpetual sacrifice. He was that perfect lamb without blemish. You know? That's the point I want to make. Yep.
Yeah, the message Yahweh Shai was coming with completely contradicted by what the Pharisees and what they were pretty much teaching. Like, you had people who, people who were sinners that came up and you was like, they believed though, and Yahweh Shai healed them. Yahweh Shai, pretty much told them, hey, your sins are forgiven because of your belief.
Right.
Not by the workings of the law.
Exactly. You know, that's right. Yeah, because like King David, matter of fact, too, if we can just hold Psalms 32, you can get your precept too.
I mean, I didn't know we still wanted to get that Romans 4.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Okay.
Somebody get Psalms 32 real quick. I think it's Psalms 32. And with Romans 4, we don't have to get it all.
Let's start at
6.
Okay.
Or matter of fact.
That's a dynamite chapter.
I know. I want to read it.
Yeah, let's start at like. Read the whole thing.
Start at 3. Yeah.
2 hours.
Kind of. Right now?
Yeah.
Kind of. This is the book of Romans 4 and 3. It says, for what saith the scripture? Abraham believed the Most High,
and it was counted unto him for righteousness.
Right, so just the mere fact that Abraham believed on the Most High, that was counted for righteousness, we're in that same lot as Abraham today, being scattered, not knowing who we were. Just the fact that we believe, we had access through Yahweh Shai. Now, once you get on a certain level of knowing, you know better, you do better. You start being obedient. You start, you stop getting lined up. You start keeping a beard on your face. You know, you keep the dietary law, this, that, and the third. Go ahead.
Verse 4, now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt.
Right, but of debt, if it's according to the law. Because we can't keep it perfectly, like you just read in James 2. Go ahead.
Verse 5, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness.
Right. Those that believe that Yahweh Shai justifies us, you know, through his blood. Go ahead.
Even as David also describes the blessedness of the man unto whom the Most High imputed righteousness without works.
Right. So, hey, we're going to get that. Like King David, you know.
Because King David, he went off.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Committed adultery.
Right.
You know, murder.
Counted, numbered Israel. But guess what? The scripture says David, he was a man after the
Most High's own heart.
So it's all about the intent of man. He was in the flesh, you know. He had so much blood on his hand, he couldn't even build a temple. That's why Solomon had to do it.
Right.
You know?
We're going to keep the law perfect when we get our new bodies.
But still, the tabernacle of David is going to still be reestablished.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And our faith is leading us into that, man. Not the keeping of the law.
Right. Just our pure belief.
But,
you know,
but it's obedience too, you know. Yes. Right. Over time, we've been built up to the point where we do keep these
things. Right, but David always felt bad. I sinned against you, O Lord. He always was broken in a contrite spirit. That's how we should feel when we go off, you know. Godly sorrow, work of repentance.
That's right.
Go ahead and get that.
In Psalms 32 from the top, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered.
Right, Yahweh Shai, hey, get up and sin no more. That's a blessing to have that, man.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, we just went into all the examples. We're just walking, seeing from the time we wake up. I'm talking about barely cold, get the cold out y'all. You look at your phone, it's just, you know how it go.
Yeah.
You know? Go ahead.
Verse 2. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity.
Right. No iniquity. You know, there ain't going to be no guile found in the mouths of the elect, pursuant to Revelation 14. Go ahead.
In whose spirit there is no guile.
Right, and whose spirit is no guile, their heart. That's where the circumcision lies, you know? Go ahead. So we can go back to Romans 4.
Let's back in the book of Romans 4 and 7. It says, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin.
Oh, man, so that's a blessed position to be in, man. Having grace, having mercy, man. Because we going to go off. A righteous man falling 7 times and get back up. Just having access to be forgiven. That's a blessing.
That's right.
You know? Yahweh Shai, he's already covered that for us, man. That's why he's worthy to be praised. You know?
That's right. Verse 9, it says, cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness.
Right, because Abraham, he got the promise without being circumcised, man. Right. Just purely off his belief. Go ahead.
Verse 10, how was it then reckoned? When he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision.
Right, where faith had to be applied. Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. You know? But his mind was still circumcised, you know? Meaning his intent of to be obedient to the will of the Heavenly Father. You know? Go ahead.
Verse 11, and he received the sign of circumcision.
That's it right there. He received the sign. He received the sign of circumcision. Go ahead.
A seal of the righteousness of the faith, which he had yet being uncircumcised.
Which he had yet being uncircumcised, man. And that's us. This is our story. Go ahead.
That he might be the father of all them that believe.
Right. The elect. The nation of Israel. We come out of that line. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, through the 12 tribes. You know.
Though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also.
Right. Being covered by Yahweh Shai's blood. That righteousness is going to be imputed unto us also.
LDS Wamba always says it, man, that Abraham's story is our story.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Babylon, Earth, Chaldea.
He had to leave his father's household, Torah, you know, to serve the Lord. All of us, we had to probably break off a lot of us from our family and stuff. And the old men, right. The old man.
Yeah.
You know, to really serve the Lord. So that's our story as well.
Yeah, to cut ties with the world.
Right.
What does the scripture say in James? To be a friend of the world is enmity with God.
Right, and we weren't doing things perfectly at the beginning, but just through that process of faith, the Lord was allowing access to us to get close to him through his son, you know?
The bridge.
And then you just go from glory to glory, you know, once you really start serving the Lord and applying that obedience to your life, you know? You really become a new man, Kadash Ayash. Go ahead.
Verse 12, it says, and the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham.
We walking in those same steps of faith of our father Abraham. Go ahead.
Which he had being yet uncircumcised.
Which he had yet being uncircumcised. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
But the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith.
Not of the law, but through the righteousness of faith, man. So I love when the other camps like to say GMS, we faith. Everybody's, hey, well, I'm hanging my hat on that.
Yeah.
You know? Go ahead.
Verse 14, it says, for if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect.
Right. Mm. The promise to be made of none effect. Go ahead.
Because the law worketh wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression.
Right, for where there is no law, there is no sin. That's how you establish what sin. Sin is transgression according to the law.
Right.
The law works wrath, though, if it's not being kept, though. Go ahead, brother.
God, just laying back off your point you just made, you know, about us being a faith-based Israelite, you know, camp. You know, that's Hebrews 11 chapter, first verse.
Right.
It says, for the faith is the substance of things hoped for. You're going to tell the word substance, it literally means foundation. You know? So, really, you call yourself an Israelite, understanding that, you know who your forefathers are. Your whole heritage is built off of, like, the roots of our heritage is built off of faith, man. That's what separates us from these other nations, because they have no faith.
Right.
So into how faith is a gift. The Lord handpicked us as a nation. I want you to, what is Isaiah chapter 43?
Right.
He said, I created you to believe in me.
Yeah.
That's what we're praying for, is to believe in him. You know?
Right.
Romans 9 chapter.
Yep, yep.
Particularly when you read it in NLT, the fourth verse, it says, for who are Israelites, we were given the privilege of worshiping and believing in the Lord. So this
right.
is a privilege, man. All based off of faith, not off our tangible things that we can do. Of course, that's going to come after we're fully persuaded in our mind. You know, of course, outward things are going to come. But first and foremost, like, you know, like I'm going into, starts on spirit.
Yep,
so
that's right.
Can I make a point? And that's beautiful what that brother said. It's like, if we had the things of what we're preaching about now, these people wouldn't believe, like the new bodies, spiritual power. It wouldn't be really sincere. You know, now, but having this beforehand, it's like, so it's even better, or makes it more real than having it be in faith.
Get a few more
precepts and back that up. This is Romans 8, and verse 24, for we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why do he yet hope for? So yeah, if they already had seen it, they wouldn't really be sincere because you know, different reasons, you know, they were coming to this thing. So
right. You know.
Just that on the road.
You know. Yeah, that's all I wanted on that. Any more precepts? Matter of fact, get Hebrews 11:1, just to back up what you just said, you know. The faith in Yahushua would be to none effect if it was according to our works in the law, you know.
That's what Yahushua
go ahead, you got it.
No, I was going to say, that's why Yahushua said, he said, pretty much, what's up, they that see me, that have not seen me yet still be
right. Right.
You know, those of us that, we know that we haven't physically seen Yahushua in the flesh in this incarnation, you know, in this body, you know what I'm saying, but
with body
we understand and know that he's with us, and we believe that based upon the word, but more importantly, the Holy Spirit, the Rakhakadash, poured upon us to make us even believe, you know, it goes back, the same way back, it's a gift, it's given, you know what I'm saying?
I got a precept to back.
Yeah, you got it.
It's 2nd Ezra 1:37, it says, I take witness the grace of the people to come, whose little ones rejoice in gladness. You all know who the little ones are. And though they have not seen me with bodily eyes, yet in spirit they believe the thing that I say. You know, and so I guess we can get that Hebrews 1:11.
Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is the substance, once again, you know, foundation of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
Right, it's evidence in the things unseen to the elect. You know, we can see it through the Spirit, you know. That's what compels us to be obedient, you know, to serve the Lord. And after that earnest expectation of receiving salvation, you know, the kingdom and so on and so forth, you know.
Right. And we can say, you know, with evidence, you know, through faith that America's going to be destroyed, man. That's like, right. We can literally, through faith, see these people on the fire, man.
Right.
Like, yeah. We can see, you know, these towers, these high buildings,
yeah,
literally falling down.
Mm-hmm.
And but that's through faith. And it says, for by it, the elders obtain a good report. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of the Most High, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear.
Yeah, I had a thought, because it's funny, you got people in the world, they have faith that America won't end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or they have faith that America will endure forever.
Mm-hmm.
Or they have faith that the Messiah won't come back. You know what I'm saying? So you're going to have those that have faith in the world, and then those that have faith in Yahweh Shem El Shai. Those that have faith that are in, it's pretty much in alignment with prophecy.
God.
Yeah, it's more sure word of prophecy.
Yeah,
that's it. Yeah. It says, verse 4, it says, by faith, Abel offered unto the Most High a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, the Most High testified of his gifts, and by it.
And that was before the Levitical law.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So that shows he just was in the spirit, you know?
It also shows having that faith inspires you to want to give a good sacrifice,
right?
To want to offend less. When you have that, when you truly have the gift of faith, it inspires you, like, I got to be on my game. You know what I mean? The whole congregation, our whole congregation, brothers on fire, making lessons 2-3 times a day, at least once a day, because brothers truly believe these things are getting ready to happen, and they want to be in good case and offend less, man, because we truly believe. You see? So that being called a faith-based Israelite is not an insult or a derogatory term.
It's
a compliment.
Okay. It says, I'm going to start from the top again, verse 4. By faith, Abel offered unto the Most High a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous. The Most High testified of his gifts, and by it, he being dead, yet speaking. You know, so, you know, through his faith, and his faith in his obedience, right now we're still speaking about, you know, Abel's sacrifice today. You know, something that was done thousands of years ago. That's the legacy.
For time, we're reading for our learning, though. You know, those examples we can go to, you know, just to build and reinforce our faith in our course today. I have a precept too. Hebrews 4:2, it says, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them.
Mm-hmm.
But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. So this thing is a thing of faith, you know. Of course, the word, the information, it takes a certain level of belief, but after that, action. And James said, what, faith without works is dead. You know, so it's just a process in just coming through this thing. But ultimately, the justification is through the blood of Yahweh Shai, you know.
That's the final form of being in this thing is faith. At the end of the day, people ask questions. People are going to scoff and buck up against what they see and what they understand, what they know. But at the end of the day, if it's not mixed with faith, it don't matter. It's just like one guy that came out there on Highway to Byway, I believe it was a couple of weeks ago. And we was telling him, like, you don't have the faith to grab this. Because, you know, was you there with Noah?
Right.
You know?
He did have faith that Adam and Eve was all by themselves, though. You know?
Yeah, he did.
Like you said, they got faith in what they believe in, too.
Right.
And they put them into a hair, so.
At the end of the day, the final form of this thing is faith. Point blank, period. People can come and question, what about this, what about that? There's so many things that were the evidence, like you were saying, I believe it was Paul just said, the evidence of the substance of it, the tangible, you can grab it in your mind, you can see it in your mind.
Right.
Which is what it's going to be. Being in a state of faith is being willing to be vulnerable,
mm-hmm.
willing to be in a place of unsurety, but go forward.
Right.
You know? Faith is it feels in that spot, man, and that's where you get charity and all these other things that come along with it. Because when you're in a state of full faith, you're vulnerable against this tangible world.
Right.
So, but it's okay.
Yeah.
We got our power to
just a few more, and then we could probably just wrap it up. So y'all got it.
This is 1 Peter 1, and it'll be 5 through verse 7. It says, who are kept by the power of the Havashim Yahushai through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. It says, and you know, like saying that power through Yahushai through faith in our salvation, that's how we're going to receive it. Like I said, we still got to do the work, but that faith and that belief is going to help us sustain that salvation. You know, we don't, none of us know we're saved, you know, but yet we're going to keep pushing until, like they say, the clouds, yeah. You know, crack over by Yahushai, yeah. You know.
He that endureth unto the end, the same yeah. shall be saved.
That's right. You know?
This is a marathon, you know. The race is not given to the swift, so.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's why Yahushua said, when he comes, shall he find safe in
him. Yep. Blessed is the man whom he shall find so doing. That's what I want to say in Matthew 24.
Yeah, so why do you think that the Lord would have made that point? If on the planet Earth, there's not going to be all kinds of turmoil taking place, hell breaking loose. You know, you're going to the hour of temptation. They're going to be put in a position where you're going to be tempted. So Yahushua said, man, look, blessed are those when he comes back, shall he find faith on the planet Earth. That's right. The key ingredient. Mm-hmm. Are you going to find anybody that believes only upon what he said he's going to do? It's going to be that bad.
Hey, same representation, but what? But the flu, you know, that was what, around 120 years that Noah got there preaching, building the ark. And I would, you know, like to say that you couldn't have somebody out there for 5 years, 10 years, kind of believe them, walk by and listen to them. But 20, 30 years, man, like, you know, so who's going to have that faith and going to endure to the end?
Yeah.
So verse 6, it says, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now of a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptation. You know, because we are going to deal with all these obstacles, these temptations. And we know a lot of the two-thirds, when we really gets down and bad, they don't want to do what? They don't want to receive that, you know, that M.
That karagma.
Because you're going to get to a point where you're going to get tested.
Yeah.
They're going to be death and bring what? Temptation. You'll be tempted to receive this.
Yeah.
If
you
have that faith, you're going to endure to the end.
Yeah, resist.
They resist.
Yep.
Verse 7, it says, the trial of your faith being much more precious than of gold that perishes.
Hey, because what's going to be on trial? And Elder Aronis has been going into this. Yeah, man. Your faith is going to be on trial, like it said. That's what needs to be built up
right.
to get through this thing, because your faith is going to be on trial. And
the trial is the test. Your faith basically is being proved. You know, we're likened as fine gold, what tried through the furnace of adversity. So our faith is going to be tried, you know, to really
right.
see if we are worthy to be received by Yahweh Shah when
right.
he comes back, you know.
Like I said, that trial is a test. And what do we do with testing? Testify. So we're going to constantly testify to spirit, how about Shem Yahushua, that, you know, through faith. All right? Because this is a faith-based thing that we have.
Oh, know? Yeah.
Correct.
It says, the trial of your faith being much more precious than of gold than perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearance of Yahushua Mashiach. Right, so we're going to keep pushing and have that faith. Mm-hmm. You know, if your faith don't perish, you know, you'll be rewarded. Because
right.
like I said to you, to Yahushua be revealed.
Yeah. That's beautiful.
I don't want to add to it. This is Ephesians 13, and I'm Salaki. This is Ephesians 1, verse 13. In whom you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, and the gospel of your salvation, in which whom also that after ye believed, ye were sealed with the Kapodash, with the Holy Spirit. Because that's again what it all comes down to, you know. And this is a faith-based thing, you know. Once we heard these things, we believe in them. It goes on to say, which is the earnest of our inheritance unto the redemption of the purchased possession. Who's that purchased possession? It's talking about us. So again, it goes back to, you know, when we heard the word, we believed through the Spirit right off the bat. You know, that we are of that number, and the way to show your belief is in our works, right? Because we know that time of temptation is coming, right? Well, every one of these brothers in the room are going to be tested, you know, in the things that we truly believe in. So, you know, we endure to the end, you know, at the end of the day.
Yeah, that earnest of the Spirit is like a down payment.
Down
payment. So, like, if you imagine something like going on a layaway that you would do back in the day before you could get it, you have the down payment that you have to put on the phone, and That's what the earnest of the Spirit is. So us receiving the Spirit in these last days is like a down payment before we receive our immortal bodies. So it's like a, in a sense, it's a sign, it's a seal. You know, you got it.
Great. That word earnest goes into the down payment thing. Yeah. Yep.
That's a great way to put that. The water.
Kind of reminds me of the dowry. You know, how the Lord's putting the dowry upon, you know, his woman.
Yeah.
You know, but that dowry is pretty much like, it's our faith is pretty much going to kind of be like that seal, that token, like I'm yours.
Just like
you
know, Abraham, we just read it. He got the seal before he was actually circumcised.
God.
So, man, it just, you know, it all go hand in hand.
Faith, brothers.
You want me to read some more Hebrew?
That's pretty much the point I want to give, unless anybody else had precepts. That's all the point. If there was anything,
go ahead.
I got Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. It says, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of the Most High. You know, y'all going into how faith is a very, very key ingredient. But yeah, we do have works, you know, because faith without works is dead.
Yeah.
But it's also another script that going to, some may say that I have faith. But some say I have faith, but not works. But let me show you faith by my works.
Yeah.
So, you know, us doing this right there is the proof
that we have
our
faith
in Yahweh Bashiach HaMashiach.
Right.
And I'm reading on down to
that goes back into that Lailway example. Because if you put, you know, $100 up on some Jordans on Lailway, what do you have to go do afterwards to finish getting the Jordans?
Gotta go work.
You know what I'm saying? And it tells you to go ahead and purchase, and that's what we're walking through now.
Yeah.
You know,
I was gonna read on to verse 9. It says, not of worse, lest any man should boast, because you know, for one, we understand that anything that we're doing right now is not even of us, according to you know, James chapter 1:17. Every good gift and every perfect gift come from the Father of all spirit, you know. So, everything we're doing is of Yahweh Bashiach, even having faith, you know, the fact that we fall, get back up, because we still have faith, that we can be saved.
That's right.
Keep going. You know, according to, you know, what the Elder said, Matthew 24, you know, he that endure to the end, the same shall be saved.
That's right.
And we all striving for that penny, so we trying to endure to the end. That's all I want to say.
Keep on.
Great point.
Boy. I got one.
Keep coming.
Yeah, you know, 2 Ezra 5:1, it says, nevertheless, as concerning the tokens, behold, the day shall come that they which dwell upon earth shall be taken away in a great number, and the way of truth shall be hidden, and the land shall be barren of faith. So that's why it's a gift, because it's rare.
Yeah,
it's not an abundant thing. Only a few choice elect men have faith. The world, as we know, the majority of people, they're without faith, man. You know?
That faith is the ticket to escape.
Exactly.
Tell me.
Yeah, so that's why we should have a renewed level of passion and enthusiasm in the service, you know? This is not a light thing, you know?
God.
That's the point I want to get, just having faith. Because a lot of people, you got a lot of people, more atheists, nihilists, all of this madness, believing in Scientology, whatever, you know? That's the point I want
to get. And that's the beauty of this thing, because, you know, you got a lot of people in church. I think that's
okay.
A lot of people in church, you know, we've all heard, you know, everything's about faith. Well, we're coming into the times that this faith is about to be tested.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Because that time of temptation, that's what's going to separate. That's when we're going to be able to see who really has it and who really doesn't.
That's the trial.
Yeah. So
be of good cheer, like Yahweh Shah said, because he's already overcame the world. That's the hope that we have at the end of the day.
Yeah.
We have that expected end, like it talks about in, what, Jeremiah 29?
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think this was really special. You know, you got
one. Sorry, I just want to make, because that made me think, but I remember you, my God, that you brought out a point at camp. This was a few months ago, pretty much being that right now we're in like boot camp.
Right.
You know, this is boot camp, doing the work, you know, all the internet still up. This is all boot camp. But eventually it's going to come to that point where we actually in the fleet.
Yeah.
We'll be in the field. That's right.
Yep. Right. I think that's the big. That's what separates what we go into a lot of the times, because a lot of these other camps, they don't go into the fact that we about to go through it.
Yep.
We're about to be put in the fire.
Right.
So what are you going to have? What are you going to need in your arsenal to be equipped with to overcome that? Right. It's the faith.
Wow.
But if you don't go into that, that's not pushed in the forefront of your congregation's mind, when they are put in the fire, they're not going to be equipped for the test. It's going to be like a pop quiz.
Right.
Ephesians
6 put on the whole armor.
Yeah, in school when you ain't study, you just in the back of class bullshitting, and then a pop quiz come up, and you just sitting there looking at the paper. Everybody walking up there passing, turning their papers in. That's going to be these people, man.
My preparation prevents poor performance. That's what they say.
Yeah.
So right now, we're in the time of the preparation for the battle, you know?
Yeah.
You ain't got to get ready if you stay ready, you know?
So we have the study guide. We got the playbook. And we say, hey, I know this test coming. I don't know exactly when, but I'm ready for it.
Pop quiz, you know, through the spirit, Lord willing, you know? Lord willing.
Yeah, Lord willing.
Lord willing. That's all I had, but I think the point's been beautifully made, unless anybody had any closing precepts from Mark.
Anybody?
I see you back there, brother.
I got 16 more precepts.
So if the point's been made, I want to give all praises to
Yahweh,
honors to our apostles and elders of Great Millstone. Shalom, peace and blessings to the hopeful elect. Till next time, shalom.
Shalom.